So good morning everyone. Let us start. Our chapter number 5 was prototyping your embedded devices, wherein it consists of basics of what do you mean by electronics, what are sensors, what are actuators, how can you go for scaling up of your electronics, some basics of embedded computing, what is your microcontrollers, what is SoC. So what you have to consider, what are the factors you need to consider while choosing your platform, specifically when we are dealing with embedded platform. So the two platforms which you are studying is your Arduino and the Raspberry Pi. However, there are many other platforms as well. But when we talk about the common platforms which are used for developing embedded devices in terms with respect to your IoT is your Arduino and Raspberry Pi. Let's go in detail. So the very first topic was, what do you mean by prototyping? So whenever I talk about prototyping, we have already seen that is nothing but a smaller version of your actual product. Similarly, on similar lines, when I talk about prototyping IoT, that also refers that you are making a small prototype of your actual system. And whenever you are starting with prototype of IoT, you are going to work with components like a breadboard. You need a sensors, you need actuators, you need your jumper wires. So whenever you connect this together and come up with a small model, that model is referred as a prototyping in IoT. So this small components, or you can say off-shelf components like your sensors, microcontroller, breadboards, circuit boards together are readily available. So you can get it from the market and you can just integrate them and come up with your model. So when we talk about prototyping of embedded devices, here we have to make sure that we are integrating very well our hardware and the software, because you have to have both technologies to be integrated very well, a hardware along with the backend front end, along with a good internet connection, because if you don't have an internet service, your information transfer will not take place. So when I talk about prototyping, it is going to deal with your hardware, your software, and a good internet platform as well. So whenever we are doing a prototyping, you have to make sure that the prototyping model is a complete ready model, so that you can take feedback from the people, you can understand their views. If any alterations is required into your model, that can be easily done, because at initial level you can do this all. Once you have developed the system and you are going to move ahead with the actual system, in that case the changes won't be possible. So whatever changes are there, you can do that changes in the prototype whenever you are designing the first initial model. Because if you talk about prototyping, it is just like you are designing an actual system. It actually shortens your path from specification to the final product. So it is making easy for you to understand your actual system in terms of every characteristics, like in terms of feasibility, in terms of how the product will scale well, how your prototype is going to work, what inputs it is going to require, what outputs it is going to give. So it actually your final product. Okay, so once this is in place, your actual system will not take much time to come up with. So whenever we are talking about prototyping where in commercialized sector, like if you're going for a commercialized prototype, in that case there is lot of planning is required, there is lots of expertise, people knowledge is required. Because most of the companies, if you see, they will always go for the in-house software prototyping. Like you will get much options with the companies with the software prototypes. However, hardware prototypes, nobody gets into it, because it's almost is very risky. The components are delicate. They are costlier as well. So in-house of prototyping development of hardware, you will find very less as compared to your software prototyping. Hardware people say that you go to the market, you get the components, you see the few videos over the YouTube and come up with your quick prototype. That is always suggested. Nobody will, or no company will give you a prototyping model ready with respect to hardware. Software you can get n number of options because it has flexibility that we all know. But since hardware comes with limitation, the flexibility is not there. So that is why the companies don't come up with prototyping of the hardware. So all you have to do it yourself only. You have to get the components. You have to get the things which are required by all. Start integrating them and start with the code. So whenever you are deciding a platform for prototyping, you have to make sure that the platform, whatever you are selecting, it should be something which is very easy for you to scale. Now, scale here I refers to that you can easily move for mass production or mass personalization. If you are selecting a platform which is very difficult to scale, then again you have to start coming up with other options, or you can say alternatives. So you have to make sure that your selection of your hardware is very much important, because what decisions you will take for selecting your hardware, that same decisions will drive the decision of or selection of your software. So it is very much important that you choose wisely so that your prototyping model is easily scalable, and in lesser time you can come up with bigger models. Okay, so let us see in detail what does this all consist of. Okay. Okay, so when we talk about prototyping, the very first thing which we are dealing is with your electronics. So when I talk about electronics, it is the initial prototyping designing which helps you. That is your electronics. There are two types of breadboards which are used. One is your solderless breadboards and another one is your soldered breadboards. So initially when you start with prototyping of your electronic, you need a breadboard wherein you are going to connect all your sensors, your actuators and all your components, off-shelf components, which will help you to design your prototype. So this, when I talk about this components which are put into your breadboards, they're referred as push-fit connection. Why we are referred as push-fit connection? Because we are taking that component, trying to push and fit into the holes which is there. That is why it is called as push-fit connection. So initially when you start your prototyping of your embedded devices, you are going to need a breadboard. So depending on your choice, you will select whether you want to go for a solderless breadboards or you want to go for a soldered one. However, solderless are very easy to carry. They are not bulky. Okay. And they are very, you can say, flexible as well in terms of push fit. So the choice is always for a solderless breadboards. We'll move to next. When we talk about electronics, it is divided into two other categories, you can say. One is your sensors and another is your actuators. So when I talk about sensors, it is nothing but medium through which you can get your information from your devices, getting your information about your surroundings. So basically sensors are devices that actually detects, or you can say responds changes to an environment and gives the result back. So when I talk about inputs to the sensors, they can be with the help of different sensors that are available. Like you have a light sensor, you have a temperature sensor, you have a pressure sensor, you have your RFID tags. So basically they sense from environment anything and give the result back to you. So the your example over the screen is your temperature sensor and another is your RFID tag. Okay, the tag itself has a sensor inbuilt into it which sends the result. Okay, you have to tap that tag over it. You can see the blue tag there and it will give you the result. So that is your sensors. Next comes your actuators. So when I talk about actuators, they work exactly opposite, or you can say reverse, of your sensors. Actuators are outputs for the device. Whenever you want to give the outputs to your device, whenever you want your devices to do something to the outside world, then you're going to use actuators. So actuators are your lights, your motors, anything which is giving an output to the environment is called as actuators. So when we talk about sensors or when we talk about actuators, both are the electronic components which are actually working with your computers and giving you some inputs and giving you some outputs. So the simple input output can have two states, as we all know that when I press on a LED button, it will have only two states. One will be state 0 and one will be state 1. That is nothing but LED turn on and turn off. So we can also use LED lights as the actuators because we want to give some output to the outside world or the environment. So LEDs can be used. You can use push buttons also. So over your screen, you can see there are two LED lights. One is a green and one is red, and there is a push button. Let's move to the next. Next topic is your scaling up electronics. So when we talk about scaling up electronics, here refers to how you can add more resources to your electronic components. Now, when we have already seen that at initial level, we need a breadboard. So breadboard is only the component wherein I can easily scale up my electronics. So scale up my electronics here refers to what? I can add more sensors, I can add more actuators, I can add ICs to it. So depending on my requirement, I can add component. But where can I scale up my component? I need a board, that is a proto board or breadboard, one and the same. So proto here refers to prototyping board, or a breadboard, both refers to the same. So initial level, if I'm thinking that I want to scale up with my electronics, then I need a breadboard. So the choice is mine that whether I want to go for a soldered breadboards, I want to go for the solderless breadboards. There are also PCBs, that is your printed circuit boards. So the choice actually lies over you, that as per your understanding, as per your needs, what selection you're going to take for the board to scale your electronics. So basically scaling up your electronics here refers to how you can easily add electronic mediums, you can say electronic components to your existing prototype. So the breadboard is only the option which is easily available, wherein I just have to push fit, I have to connect it, and my prototype is ready. Next is your embedded computing basics. So we all know that when I talk about embedded computing, it is a basics that deals with how your embedded devices are going to work. What are the components which are required? Because now embedded system has become a very common, you can say, part and parcel of your modern life. Whatever we are using, like you can tell about your remote controls, you can tell about your washing machine, microwave oven, everything is designed with embedded computing basic. It has embedded into it. So wherever we see, it is a need of an hour. It is which is commonly used by every one of us. So when I talk about embedded in respect to IoT, we have a sensors, we have actuators, we have thermostats, we have switches, we have routers. There are so many things which are coming under your embedded computing basics. So when we talk about core basics of embedded computing, which really helps us to have a real-time computing, is the first is your microcontroller. So whenever I talk about microcontroller, it is nothing but it's a compact integrated circuit. And it has some specific operation to be done in your embedded system. So when I talk about microcontroller, it has its own processor, it has its own memory, it has its own input-output peripherals, and all this is managed over a single chip. And that is single chip is, you can say, designed or specialized, which does all these things. The smaller and the easier is to build into your custom devices, because the more smaller it is easier to integrate in small devices and it gives you best results. However, the problem only with this is what the RAM capabilities which gives is always in your kilobytes. The storage is also in your kilobytes. The storage is something which is a problem, or you can say an issue here. But overall, when you talk about a single chip which has its own memory, it has its own processor, it has its own input output peripherals over just a single chip, is a big thing over the devices. So when you talk about microcontrollers, they actually control all your devices, like your remote controls, your appliances, all are the part of your microcontrollers. Let's move to next. Next is system on chip. System on chip and microcontrollers are both same, so don't confuse yourself. Okay. System on chip, they're also called as SoC. They're also an integrated circuit or IC that works over your single chip. It has its own, again, memory. It has its own processor. It has its own, you can say, your input-output peripheral. So it is a single chip which does everything. All the components are connected to the single chip. Okay. This has actually used almost in all your personal computers and laptops. And the main intention of using SoC is to have power consumption. The power consumption will be less and the performance will be high. So for that, we have integrated SoC, that is system on chip. So it can perform a variety of operations, you can say, just like your wireless communications, signal processing. So all your input, output management, your internal management, your memory management, everything will take over this single chip. So that is system on chip. So microcontroller and SoC are almost same. So don't confuse yourself. And the which is used here in your most of the devices is Broadcom, that is BCM 283 7. So this is something which I have used with your Raspberry Pi, which is using a Broadcom SoC or microcontroller. Next is your choosing your platform. So whenever we talk about choosing a platform, it is very much important because the decisions are going to drive your hardware decisions and software decisions as well. So choosing the platform has to be very wise. When we talk about choosing the platform, the three important characteristics which plays a big role here is your price, second is your performance, and third is a capability. Because this all we are going to try to achieve, and this all should fit into our needs. That is very much important. Whenever we try to balance price, the performance somewhere or other get compromised. Whenever I try to balance compromise, when I go to compromise performance, the price somewhere increases. So it is very much difficult to balance this all three, and then it should fit your needs and the product has to be ready. So it is always there up and down into it when you try to balance them. So you have to make sure that whenever you are trying to balance this, or whenever you are trying to fit into your needs, price, performance and capabilities, don't just settle for one solution and just move on. You should try to find alternatives, and the one which will be best for you, which you think this is the most optimum solution or alternative for me, then only settle yourself for that. Don't go for just one or two options and just you start with it. So you have to look for many options, and then finally you have to decide that what you have to go for. So when we are talking about choosing a platform, apart from price, performance and capabilities, there are more important factors we need to consider that actually drives your performance. So the factors that will actually drive our performance which are required, let us see what are they. The very first is your processor speed. So whenever I talk about processor speed, that is nothing but what processor you are using, because the processor is the important element which will make your system work faster. It works with your CPU, which helps you to do your tasks faster. Along with computer processor, there is a CPU speed, and this together makes your system work faster. There is something called as clock speed when we talk about processor. So the clock speed determines how your information is received, how quickly that information is processed toward the system or a computer, and the results are given back. So the more faster is your processor, the more fast result you can get it. So if you don't want much time for to wait for getting your result, if you want spontaneous results, in that case you should go for a good processor speed. Intel is a company who has been in since years, who are making good processors. So you can go with that option. There are many options available when I talk about processors with respect to computers or laptops. That is your Core i5, Core i7, along with the generation, 8 generation, 10 generation. So now it is 10 generation which is going on. So your processor speed actually makes your system work very fast. So more best is your processor, the more new processor you are opting for, the speed of your system will be more faster. And this along goes with your CPU speed, and together makes a complete fast working system. So this is the very first characteristic with respect to performance, which is very much important. So you have to make sure that you are going for an updated processor so that you will get a good speed and the tasks which you perform will be faster. Next is your RAM. Just like a processor, RAM also plays a very important role, because you are going to have applications into your system, and that application requires some amount of memory to make them run smoothly. So RAM actually helps you to make your application run smoothly, so that you can say it is just a working memory for your applications. So if you want your applications to load fast, to give you result fast, to make them work very smoothly without any lag, so you should have a good RAM. The more is your RAM size, the more smoothly your applications will run. If your RAM size is less, so in that case, the load over the CPU increases and it actually degrades your overall computer performance. So it is very much important that you should have a good RAM size, a sufficient RAM size, so that there is no load over the CPUs to make your application run. So when we talk about embedded devices, usually the RAM sizes comes in your KBs only. Okay, you must have seen in your RAM size of your Arduino and Raspberry Pi, where it is just in MBs or KBs. So when we talk about hardware devices or embedded devices, the size always is less. that is only the constraint always. Rest everything is fine, but the size is always less. It is always in your kilobytes. Next is characteristics or the performance measure is your networking. So when we talk about networking, it refers to how well your computers are connected with each other, how the information transmission is taking place. So in IoT, it's all about your networking, because all the information is sent from your environment. That real-time information is saved over the clouds. So the analytics takes place, results are generated. So it is connection of multiple anonymous computers. Information is sent or gathered through the sensors and stored. So networking here refers to how your information is being shared across the multiple platform, how information is being stored. So when we talk about networking, we need a good internet connection. So we should always go for wired connections rather than wireless. Because if you go for the wireless, there are many complications into respect to the configuration. At times, they may not work well because they are connectionless. So connection at times suddenly goes off. So the transmission stop and it is an inconsistent state. So it is always suggested that whenever you are selecting a networking, in that case, the networking should be with respect to your wired Ethernet connections. Always go for the wired connection rather than going for the wireless, so that you would have no problem into it. Since we know IoT comes with so many applications, so all your application requires internet as a platform, because without internet, there will be no information sharing. So always go for a strong platform where your internet will be end-to-end, your connections will be able to share the information. So for that, you should always go for a wired Ethernet rather than going for any wireless. However, we can know that Wi-Fi is also available. It is now mostly adopted. But if it is strong Wi-Fi, then only you can opt for it. But as a first preference, when you want end-to-end communication without any problems, without any obstacles, then you can go for a wired connections. Next is your USB port. So when we talk about USB port, these are the port which you are really, you can see in your laptops, in your computers, even your embedded devices comes with this USB ports. So USB stands for Universal Serial Bus, and these are the ports which are actually there into your computers or laptops, and that helps you to connect your cables, connect your devices, connect your portable devices. So all your connection, whichever you want to have it to your devices, you can do it with this USB port. So these are the standard ports which are common for all the devices. So it is very easy to integrate this port with the cable connection, because all your cable connection comes over with the size of the USB ports. So basically, it really helps you to have a short distance communication by connecting your, you can say, devices into this ports. So that is your USB port. You can connect your other peripherals as well, whatever you want, with this USB ports. Next characteristics is your power consumption. So whenever I talk about power consumption, it refers that how much power is consumed by your devices. So as I've told you before as well, the more fast is your processor, the more devices will be hungry and the more power they are going to consume. So the devices which are equipped with newer technologies, which are actually designed with the new processors, their requirement is always more power, because they are doing so many tasks in the background. There's so much processing taking place. So it is obvious, when so much processing is taking place, you need more power, you need more energy to consume or to do the task. So the current processor, you can say all the faster processors like your Core i7, 10th generation, all your processors need more power to consume. So whenever we talk about power consumption, at times if your current battery is not supporting, your power consumption is more, so you can go for an external batteries also, that is your solar power, your external batteries, wherein you can easily connect with your devices and you can give the power. So you are not only relying for your inbuilt powers or inbuilt batteries for processing. Now you can have an external batteries as well. So you can install the external batteries as per your requirements. So it is always suggested that whenever you see that your devices are consuming more power, let them rest for a while, put them into the sleep mode, because this will allow the processors to work more faster when they come back. Okay, so it is always suggested that don't go for continuous consumption of power. Don't let your devices work long hours. Try to give them some break. Try to put them into sleep mode so that once they come back, they can start processing the results more faster. So you have to make sure that they has to be put into sleep mode after 2 or 3 hours of the working. Sleep mode option is now available in all the devices. Even if case if it is not available, then you just simply shut off your devices and let them rest for a while. So the power consumption here refers to how much power is consumed by the devices. So the more faster is your processor is working, the more power it is going to consume. Let's move to next. Next is your interfacing with the sensors and other circuitry. So this refers to that how you are connecting your sensors and other circuitries that can be your actuators, that can be your ICs over a breadboards or a protoboard. So now interfacing has become very easy because you just simply need a breadboard and all the connections has to be placed over it. Then you have to write the code, you have to run it, and you have to see. So here in this example, you can see that there is one LED light that is sensing the temperature and humidity of the environment, which is connected to your Raspberry Pi kit. And there is a sensor which is sensing the information, and that information which is being sensed is being displayed over the LED screen. So whenever we talk about interfacing or interacting to the internet, your devices need to interact with either sensors to gather the information, and along with sensors you need an actuators which will give the output to the environment. So that can be in terms of LEDs. So here we have taken an LED. It can be in terms of your motors. It can be in terms of your any device which gives a signal to the environment that whatever is asked has been done. There are also other, you can say, common devices or circuitries which are used. That is your ICs. There are two types of ICs which you will see into your practicals. One is your I2C and one is your SPI. That is your serial buses. Okay, let's move to the next. Next is physical size and form factor. So physical size and form factor plays a very important role whenever you are choosing or selecting, because it actually decides that how will be your actual system look like. So it is very much important, or it is very much in essential that you start designing your form factor and size. The sketching was one step wherein you start designing your exterior of your devices. So you have to decide before only that how your physical device is going to look, what will be the actual size. So this is very much important, because nowadays people are not going for big devices, they are going for small devices, because portability is something which is very much important for us, so that we can carry them very well. It should be light in weight. It should not be much bulky. So when we talk about physical and size and form factor, it deals with what is your actual size of your system, how it is going to look, whether being physically small, whether it is going to give everything what I need or not. So now everybody is going for making small devices more powerful rather than going for a bigger devices to make powerful, as they themselves are powerful. If you see all the big devices, they themselves are powerful. But if to make a small devices powerful is something which is need of R, you can say, or this is something which is easily acceptable by everyone, because everyone wants flexibility, they want portability. Now everybody, if you go for a selection of a laptop, you will always go for a laptop which is light in weight, not for the one which is bulky or which is heavy, because there are reasons. You want to have a portability, you want to have a flexibility so that you can carry anywhere, you can easily hold it. So there are many, you can say, choices depending on the people. But when I talk about physical size and form factor, everybody wants to go with the small sizes that should be light in weight and that should have more productivity. That is, I guess, common for every one of us. So when we talk about physical size and form factor in computer, that is nothing but your size, you can say your configuration, the physical arrangement of your computing devices, that all together decide your physical size and form factors. When you talk about physical size and form factor, the internal components such as your motherboard, such as your processor, all also have to be into that sizes. Like now you can see the microcontrollers, all your motherboard, all are also of that small sizes, because you cannot have a big sizes over a small physical design. You should have a small as well. So with physical design, external physical design is changing. Along with that, your internal components designing are also changing. Because when I talk about size, both should match, your external and your internal components. So that was your physical size and form factor. So the factors which drives is your first is your processor speed, second is your RAM, third is your networking, fourth is your USB port, fifth is your power consumption, fifth is your interfacing with sensors and circuits, and the last is your physical size and form factor. So always whenever you are choosing your platform, along with the price, performance and capability, try to look into the performance characteristics also. These are all your performance characteristics that will actually help you to build a good prototype. Along with the scalability will be easy, the working will be faster. So you have to look for these options as well. Let's move to the next. Next is your Arduino. So when we talk about embedded devices, we are going to deal with the two examples here, or the two platforms you can say. One is your Arduino and the second is your Raspberry Pi. So whenever I talk about Arduino, always remember it is an open source prototyping hardware platform, and that actually helps you to build your projects, your embedded projects, your electronic projects. So it consists of two things. One is your physical programmable circuit board, which you can see over your screens, and the second is the software ID. The software ID which you are using is supportable on all the platforms like your Windows, your Mac platform and Linux platform. So that is supportable for all the platforms. So when I talk about Arduino, it consists of your digital pins, it consists of your analog pins, it consists of your LEDs, microcontrollers, reset button, USB connector, USB interface chip, crystal oscillators, voltage regulator and power port. So when I talk about Arduino, it consists of this all components. So the very first characteristics of your Arduino is IDE. So when I talk about IDE, it stands for your integrated development environment. So that is nothing but an environment wherein you are going to write your code. Always remember, the code in Arduino is referred as sketch, which we must have already seen before as well. So whenever you write your code, you have to write your code, you have to compile it. Okay. And then you have, if the compilation is successful, then you can see the results. So that is your IDE. There is a simple IDE where you have to just copy paste your code, or you have to run the code. And then once your code running is done, you can see the results. Second characteristic is your pushing code. So when I talk about pushing code, that is the very first code which you are writing into your IDE. You are running them. Okay. Whenever you run, if it is correct code, then it will be compiled and run. If it is not correct code, then the errors will be seen by you, and accordingly you have to correct them. If your compilation is in place, your running is successful, the code gets transferred to your Arduino flash memory and you can see the results. If the code is unsuccessful, you have to solve the compilation errors there and there itself. And when once you have solved them, then only it will move to your flash memory. So once the results are correct, all compilation errors are solved, then only it saves into its flash memory. So the operating system which is used here is Dune operating system. Always remember, Arduino doesn't come with its own operating system. That is why it uses real-time operating system. That is RTOS, that is named as Dune, D-U-I-N, okay? So this Dune operating system is compatible with all the boards of Arduino, and they actually helps to do the real-time processing of the task or multitasking task of the Arduino. Next is language. So when I talk about language, which is used in Arduino, is C++. So all your libraries for reading and writing will be from your C++, along with there will be libraries from your Arduino platform as well. So your libraries are, we have already seen, digital read, digital write, analog read and analog write. So whenever you are reading your data from digital pin, you are going to use digital read. When you are writing, you are going to use library, that is digital write, that is nothing but method. Similarly, for analog input pins, there is analog read and analog write. So these are the pins which are very important, which helps your sensors or actuators to take the information from them and give you the results. Along with this, there will be other libraries as well. There are two libraries, that is nothing but your setup and loop. So when I talk about setup, that is nothing but the initial booting of your board, where all your pins will be initialized, all your sensors, actuators, all your methods which you have declared in your setup mode will be initialized. Similarly, we have something called as loop. So when I talk about loop, that refers to your routine which is running again and again. All your devices doesn't turns off completely. All your hardware devices, they goes into the sleep mode. Once you turn on them, they come back to the actual mode. So that is called as loop. So any embedded devices, if you see, they are not going on a sleep mode completely. They are there into the state. As soon as they get any inputs from your end, they come back to the original state. So that is your loop. So all your functions are going into the loop again and again and giving you the result. So that is your reading, your writing, that function goes into your loop. Next is your debugging. So when I talk about debugging, the C++ language is used for debugging. So there can be many compilation errors. There can be any syntax error in case if you are not declaring them properly. So the scenario of debugging will be just as same as your C++ debugging. Wherein if you have made any mistake, then that mistake you need to correct it. You have to check all your variables. You have to check all your semicolons, termination statements are proper or not. Methods are being declared correctly or not. So all that comes under your debugging. Last characteristics is your openness. So when I talk about openness, it refers to how open is it. Since Arduino is an open source platform, so it is open in terms of your hardware and in terms of your software. So that was all about your Arduino. Next we had was Raspberry Pi. So when I talk about Raspberry Pi, it is just like it is a mini computer. It is a small single board computer where you can connect all your devices, like your peripherals, like your keyboard, your mouse, your display, everything you can connect it. Okay. It just can act as your mini personal computer. So the components here are, there are 4 USB ports. There is Ethernet LAN port. There are 40 GPIO pins. GPIO stands for general purpose input output. Okay, wherein there will be some GND, that is your ground points. Along with that, there will be other points as well. So whenever you are connecting your any sensors, your circuits, you have to make sure that your one connection will be your ground connection, another will be your any other connection which you want to put into your breadboards. So the microcontroller which is used here is your Broadcom BCM2837. Then you have your display interfaces wherein you can connect your all your display devices. Your camera can also be connected here. Then we have a micro USB port. We have your HDMI port. We have your camera interfaces. You have your audio and video output. So you can even see real-time audio and video output with your Raspberry Pi. So when I talk about Raspberry Pi, it is just like a mini computer, but it is slower than your laptop or desktop. But it can actually provide you with expected features or capabilities at a lower consumption. There are many versions of Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi model A, Pi A plus, B, B plus, 0. So there are n numbers of the model Raspberry Pi have come up with. Operating system which is used here is your Raspbian operating system. And the programming language which is used here is Python. So that PI which is here is refers to your Python. Rather than PY, they have written PI. So when we talk about debugging, the debugging will be just same as you do the debugging of your Python language. The reason where they have selected Python language is the syntax are very easy to understand. It is not that difficult. It is simple English language syntaxes. So it is not much difficult for you to understand them. However, if your compiler catches your number of syntax errors, or you can say there are many undeclared variables, so accordingly you have to solve the runtime errors which will be there accordingly to get the result. The best part of this is that if there are programming errors, it at the compilation time, the program will not crash, which happens in your C++ if you logically see. This won't happen here, so your programs are running, so you can easily correct them and you can get the results. When I talk about openness, it is indeed open because the platforms which we are using is one of the platform is Linux. And when I talk about Linux, it is a free open source platform, and Raspbian operating system, when it is working over it, so it is obvious that the openness will be there. Okay. Next, we are going to see the difference between your Raspberry Pi and Arduino. So when I talk about Raspberry Pi, what is Raspberry Pi? It is nothing but a mini computer which has the Raspbian operating system. And since this operating system helps you to run your programs, multiple programs at a single time. So whenever you want to install your Raspberry operating system, you have to use Noobs. Okay, Noobs installation is very much important, which helps you to install your Raspbian operating system. So Noob stands for new out of box software. When I talk about Arduino, it contains your microcontroller and it is one of the part of your computer, and it can run only one program at a time, and it most of the time it runs the same program again and again. When we talk about CPU speed in your Raspberry Pi, the CPU speed is 700 megahertz. Wherein if I talk about Arduino, the CPU speed is 84 megahertz. RAM size in Raspberry Pi is 512 MB. RAM size in Arduino is just 96 KB. Storage, which our Raspberry Pi comes with, is your 512 KB. Arduino storage is with the help of the SD card. That is, the SD card can support with 4GB plus. When I talk about battery backup, it is difficult to have a battery backup in Raspberry Pi. However, in Arduino, it is easy to have a battery backup. When I talk about Raspberry Pi, it requires installation of many libraries and many softwares whenever you want to interface your sensors, your actuators, or any other circuitry components. Arduino doesn't require any library. Okay, it directly integrates easily with your libraries. It has a simple interface, that is Sketch, wherein you have to declare and you can directly start, because it has many inbuilt methods. Okay, you can see there is Blink, there is many other inbuilt methods. So it doesn't require any installation of libraries or softwares. You can directly start working with your Arduino. Raspberry Pi is expensive. Arduino is available at low cost. It is lesser expensive than Raspberry Pi. When I talk about Raspberry Pi, it can be easily connected to your internet with the help of your Ethernet port. You can see there is an Ethernet port. So using that port and your USB port, you can connect your Wi-Fi dongles. When I talk about Arduino, it requires some external hardware whenever you want to connect to the internet. And you have to always make sure that whenever you are connecting any external hardware, you have to mention the same thing into the code as well with respect to Arduino. In Raspberry Pi, it is not required because the port themselves are there and you can easily connect them with the help of ports. When I talk about onboard storage with Raspberry Pi, it doesn't have its own storage, but with the SD card, you are going to provide then onboard storage. So all your Raspbian operating system will be saved on your SD card, and that SD card has to be put into the SD card slot. Okay. And then you can use it. When I talk about Arduino, it has its onboard storage, that is 4GB plus. When I talk about USB port in Raspberry Pi, there are four USB ports. When I talk about Arduino, it has only one. So this becomes a limitation, that it has just one USB port. Because if you have many USB ports, you can easily connect the devices. When I talk about processor, the processor which is used in your Raspberry Pi is from ARM. When I talk about processor which is used in Arduino, it's AVR. So the processor which is used in Arduino is Atmega328. And the processor which is used in your Raspberry Pi, it is from your ARM family. In Raspberry Pi, you have to make sure that you have to shut down it well. Otherwise, there will be corruption of your files and there will be software issues. This you will come across when you will start doing the practical. Because if you are not shutting off your Raspberry Pi kits, then in that case, your SD card always gets stopped working and it gets corrupted very fast. So you have to always make sure that you have to turn off your Raspberry Pi kits. You can't keep it on for a longer time. The files get corrupted themselves. When we talk about Arduino, it is just your plug and play devices. If your power is connected, the program will be running. If your power is disconnected, then it simply stops. So it is just like your plug and play. Your connection has to be active connection. If it is active, then you can see the program running. If it is not active, then it simply stops. So the language which is used in your Raspberry Pi is your Python. But along with that, C, C++ are also pre-installed. because most of the people has flexibility over those languages, not with Python if they have not knowing the background of it. Arduino uses C, C++ language. Okay, so that was all your chapter number 5, wherein we have seen the embedded basics. What is your embedded devices? What are the sensors? What are actuators? What do you mean by microcontroller? What do you mean by SoC? And the two comparative study of your Raspberry Pi and Arduino. Comparison study of Raspberry Pi and Arduino is very, very much important. All the choosing the platform performance features like your RAM, microcontroller, SoC are also very important from exam point of view. Okay, that's it for the day. Thank you, everyone.